introduction, but I wanted to do that at the outset. Go ahead, please.
It's okay. So anyway, I would be renting half of the greenhouse here, this shed that's a three-sided shed, and this northwest corner of the property. And, you know, of course, you know, the parking lot and the shared uses. So the nominal floors will stay the same as usual. I'll just be renting that extra space.
In green, the space in green?
Yes,
okay.
And also part of this and this shed right here. So, and I'll be selling mostly plants, 90% plants, but I will be selling some soil, some pottery, some garden design type stuff, but that will all be minimal, 90% plants. So, and the time frame would be, I would be open for 7 months out of the year, so it would be open in April through October, and I'll get into more about the timing at the end of the presentation, the traffic and the timing. And I would be open 7 days a week from 9 to 6. So I just wanted to, before I go into the site accommodations, I just wanted to clarify the scope of this. And just for your information, I worked at Hadley Garden Center for 2 seasons when I first moved here. In fact, I still work for them. I do their newsletter for them, and they're friends of mine. And in the summertime, or in the spring, the busiest time of the year, they hire between 30 and 40 people to man their operation. So in terms of this operation, I would hire 2-3 people. So that's the difference between, that's the scope, the volume difference. So if someone asks me, oh, is it gonna compete with Hadley Garden Center? Well, no, not at all. It's in size, very small. So the first thing I wanted to go over is the installation of the fence. And I think the board members have the specs from a Fitzgerald fence. But the fence would add on to the existing fence here. And so it would cut across the northwest corner and just kind of wrap around that area. And of course it would meet the setbacks on the side closest to the Y. There's a 15-foot setback there. There's a 10-foot setback on the Woodlawn Street. And then there would be a 12-foot opening that would be in the parking lot. And so that opening would be the major place where people would go in. There's also an opening down here that's existing. This opening would also be so that all the snow, when I'm closed, you know, all the snow can go in that area also.
What do you mean by opening? Opening in the fence?
A gate.
A big gate in the fence.
Okay. Yep, 6 foot, 2 6-foot gates. So, and the reason I chose a chain link fence around there is mostly because of security. I mean, I was thinking of security the whole time. The second reason is obviously you can see through it. And so, you know, that's good for business, but really in a residential area to put up any other kind of fence, I think would feel foreboding and blockading. So I also think that, I mean, it's a great place to plant. You can climb things up it, you can hang things on it. I mean, it lends itself to beautifying that area. And then in this particular plan, which I think you guys have also, there's a very specific set of plants all around the perimeter of that. And for that, I've chosen evergreens, deciduous, flowering shrubs, and some perennials. And so that would be beautified, but also I've chosen plants that would be very low maintenance. Because the last thing I want to do is take care of those plants. I want to take care of the plants inside here. So there are evergreens, so in the wintertime, but there'll also be a lot of color, too. So that's the fence. The second item to talk about is the traffic. And there's 4 different items in the traffic. The first item is the Prospect Street opening over here. And originally, I had designed a smaller opening that was a right-hand exit opening only, but Wayne Fiden had told me that the board was probably not going to approve that because they wanted that curb cut to be closed off. So I'm not going to discuss that whole plan. Instead, we've come up with an idea for a gate there. And so the opening would stay the same width. There would be two metal posts and a chain across there. That would be the first option for a gate.
I'm sorry, you're talking about on Prospect?
On Prospect, yeah.
And which board was Wayne referring to?
Us.
Right.
Okay, I think actually
what was stated was that there was a staff strong recommendation to the board that that be closed off because it's a dangerous location next to that intersection.
Thank you.
Right. Is there, if this weren't otherwise grandfathered, would there only be one curb cut allowed anyway?
You're only allowed one curb cut per parcel, unless it's for safety reasons.
Right.
And you need a second one.
And so the you'd be reducing a nonconformity,
right.
Could you say that, by eliminating the Prospect Street curb cut?
Right.
And so your proposal now is to have a chain, two posts and a chain, and when would it be opened?
Right, so the main reason for having it would be when there are deliveries. And Chip gets, cut flower deliveries, I would get plant deliveries. And as you can see, for a truck to come in here and try to turn around and go out that woodland exit would be virtually impossible. So having this open here, then you could have a truck come in there and go out this exit.
And
so,
do you know how often that would likely happen?
Well, for a garden center, in the busiest times, you might get two deliveries a week. That's for May and June. Otherwise, you might get one a week or one every other week.
Now with Prospect Street curb cut closed off with a fence or a chain, that's going to add to the burden on the Woodlawn curb cut because basically
right.
All customers would be in and out on Woodlawn.
Right.
Okay.
What is the width of the Woodlawn curb cut or your intended width?
The existing width, I believe, is 21 feet. For the Woodland and 21 feet for the Prospect Street. So, another option for this would be, a fence like this, a gate like this that is, I just took this picture from the Y,
the history on that, by the way, is the Y was required to eliminate that second curb cut when it got permitted for additional parking, again, to reduce a nonconformity. The difference in that case obviously was both curb cuts were in Massasoit, whereas here one is on Prospect.
Right.
But I think we would have to weigh in the balance that reducing the hazard of having the Prospect Street curb cut near that really tricky intersection. But go ahead.
Right. So would you like me to describe the other alternative? Because that I have a little more detailed picture of it. That, I have kind of a very simplistic drawing, but my original idea was to shrink that to 15 feet and make it a right-hand exit only.
I think that's enough for me to know right now.
That's good. You can continue.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. And I talked with the DPW, and they stated that there's no signage necessary for if there's a gate there. Certainly, we could put up a sign if the board thought we should, but the DPW said there's no signage necessary for that. The second thing, as far as traffic is, I don't know if you've noticed, but the parking is redirected. So the proposal is to put the parking facing the Nunnelman building rather than facing Woodland. And the reason for that would be to have a better traffic flow. so that if people are coming in Woodland, they're not kind of swinging around and facing this way. So it also is very much a safety factor, so that when cars park towards the building here, they won't have to cross the parking lot in order to enter into Woodland, to Nettlemans, or enter into the Garden Center. There's also the possibility of a handicap spot right here. So it makes sense all the way around. And also to the beautification of the site, it leaves the woodland as you drive past it, it leaves this whole, you know, fence right here that will be covered with roses so that you could see that, right, rather than look at the cars.
And I think, I can't quite hear, I think you mean Woodlawn. Woodlawn is the street?
Yeah, Woodlawn.
Yeah.
Did I say Woodland?
Yeah.
Just want to make sure we're talking about the same street.
Yeah, it's Woodlawn.
Yep.
So and then as far as the traffic study goes, I did kind of a small graph for that I think you guys probably have also. And so I just wanted to explain that a little bit. So the traffic flow, and it's in trips per month, and the traffic flow at Nettlemans, they have pretty much an online business now. So they have very limited traffic. The two times that they have traffic are Valentine's Day, which is basically a one-day holiday, and the other one is Mother's Day, which is a weekend holiday in May. So otherwise, their traffic is, very minimal. So the traffic at the Garden Center, and knowing that, remembering that the Garden Center would be only open for 7 months. So 3 of those months, the traffic is very small. So that would be April. I mean, people are thinking about planting. They're not actually actively planting, but they're thinking about it. So that's why you're open to get things started. The other time that's a very slow time at a Garden Center is August. And people are always surprised by that, but really it's hot and people have already planted and they're also harvesting things from their gardens, so they're not actively looking to plant things. So that's a low time, and also October is, you know, the end of the season. So the two times that are active in 350 trips per month, that would be July and September. And then the busiest times would be May and June, and those would be 600 trips per month.
And what's the source of that projection or that data?
So the source of that data would be 28 years of experience having a garden center approximately the same size. So, at one point I talked to Wayne about projections, and he was saying, well, there's some garden center projections. And every garden center is very different. You know, some garden centers have produce, some garden centers specialize in the fall, some are, you know. So, like I said, I think that my experience in having a garden center similar size and also similar location is where I drew my data.
So your other garden center was in a essentially a residential neighborhood?
Yeah, it was a mixed use. It wasn't totally residential. Yeah.
Well, I guess in this case, the Y is on two sides,
right.
And the park is on across the
right,
street,
right,
but then otherwise it's residential.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So the other thing I wanted to talk about as far as traffic is timing. So in a garden center, the busiest time is the weekends. And as far as the Prospect Street intersection there, that time is the slowest time because there's not traffic from school and business. So the other busier time for a garden center is during the week is middle of the day, between, say, 12 and 3. And that also is different than the intersection at Prospect Street, which is busier when school gets out and when people get out of businesses, so going home. So as far as any type of business being there, it's actually a great business that's opposite the traffic flow of what's existing. So. And then as far as a minor thing to decrease traffic, we're going to have a bike rack right here. We're also offering a bike trailer. If people come on their bike, they can take their trailer and bring their plants home. And another idea was to offer free delivery for anyone within a mile radius that came on foot that wanted to buy plants, that we would drop off their plant material for them. So, like I said, I fully recognize that those are, you know, small things, but they're also a way to start connecting the community to this particular business. The other thing I wanted to say is that there won't be a sign, because we already have two signs, and it was my understanding that there wasn't another possibility of a sign there. So the existing sign that Nolan and Flores have, which is a yellow sign that you can add things in, the name of the garden center will be right there, but there won't be any other signs, and also there won't be any other modifications to buildings. There's no buildings being built, there's no modifications to any buildings. What there will be is a very vibrant new look and a new business at Nolan's. And that would be reflected by, there's going to be plantings around the sign here. The split rail fence is going to have a bank of nonstop blooming roses. All across here, of course, there'll be plantings all around the perimeter of the fence. And inside here, there'll be tables with plants. There'll basically be plants everywhere. So I'm hoping that will add to the vibrancy of that whole corner there. So that's my presentation, if there's any questions.
Thanks. I have a question. One of the threshold issue for us, before we can get to any other issues, mm-hmm. is whether the concept of a finding is a determination that a change, extension, or alteration of an existing use that's otherwise grandfathered in and otherwise not allowed in the zoning district, that the change, extension, or alteration of an existing use is not substantially more detrimental to the characteristics of the neighborhood. But before we even get to the question of whether what you're describing is substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood, we have to make a determination as to whether this is an expansion or alteration of an existing use. So could you comment a little bit about, I think most of us are familiar with Nuttallman's,
sure.
but what Nuttallman's does and has done for years in their store,
mm-hmm. so
in comparison to what you will be doing in the nursery.
Right.
Because if we are not able to determine that this is an expansion or alteration of an existing use, namely what Nuttallman's
right.
has been doing there under grandfathered
right.
status, that's the end of the analysis.
Right. So I can absolutely comment on that. I mean, Nuttallman's has been in business for 41 years. They have, when you walk in the door, they have a picture right up there of all their greenhouses. And they, in their heyday, I mean, they grew plants, they sold plants, and they still do. So Chip and I have talked extensively about how these two would overlap, and that there are plants that he sells that I'm gonna sell. How are we gonna handle that? So he's already selling those plants. It's just really adding on to use
right.
the property that hasn't been
right.
used currently. But previous to that, it was all plants.
Right, and is it accurate to say he sells plants, his business is and has been selling plants from an indoor facility, and yours would be selling plants from an outdoor facility?
Well, I suppose
it's,
you could
it's not
say
a trick question. to me, that would feel like a proper expansion of an existing use. That's a good thing
right,
for
right.
you. So I'm not, it's not a leading question.
Well, so I would say yes to that, but also he does use this area here and sells plants outside also.
Yeah.
So both, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let me just say one thing. I do use that from...
I'm sorry, I know who you are, but you're, for the record, your name, please.
Chip Collins.
Thank you.
So I do still sell outdoor plants there for a couple of months in the early spring.
Okay.
So I do sell like annuals and a few perennials and hanging baskets.
Right.
So, but on a very small scale.
Right.
So really what this is doing is just bringing it a little bit bigger scale, but I still use it as a, to sell outdoor plants.
Outdoors. And indoors you sell plants. I've been
yes,
in there.
I do in the greenhouse.
You have plants for sale
in
a greenhouse.
Yes.
I just want us to
more they're
to
more
to realize
indoor,
that we have to be comfortable with that.
They're in houseplants.
Houseplants.
Not
versus outdoor plants.
Right. But I do sell outdoor plants.
Outdoors on a smaller scale.
Scale.
So
yes.
In that sense, the argument is this is truly an expansion of an existing use, because those are the magic words.
Yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Well, the question I would ask to that is, what's the percentage of, what do you picture the percentage of your total sales to be in terms of plant versus non-plant items?
So I'm thinking that 90% would be plants and 10% would be non-plant items. You know, it's a little tricky to have a garden center if you don't sell soil, or if you don't sell, you know, planters. Yeah, you know, a trowel, but you have to remember that really I don't have in this agreement, I have very little indoor space. So I have half this greenhouse is kind of my indoor space, but all the rest of this is outdoors. So anything that I sell has to be weatherproof and it's also not my focus. You know, I love plants. I love nature, and that's the vision for this.
And it's a very good question. The 10% of non-plant items, mm-hmm. very briefly, can you give some examples other than soil? And then I'm curious if in the current use, there are similar non-plant items for sale in the facility.
Sure, for example, baskets. I might sell some baskets that you could put plants into. And I think that Chip sells baskets. He also sells, I've seen some planters there, some you know pots, okay. different decorative
so,
pots.
So even with the non-plant
sure.
inventory,
right.
Both the existing use and the proposed expanded use include
sure. uh-huh.
similar non-plant items.
Right. So there might be decorative items. For example, with a hanging basket, you'd have a hook that comes over so you can put your hanging basket on there.
You won't have any inventory that has nothing to do with plants.
I haven't ordered the inventory yet.
What you're not projecting?
No, I mean, it's all garden plant related.
Right.
Yeah. I don't see anything that I would have that would
okay.
be non-plant related, or non-garden related, rather.
Yeah, my interest was in knowing if it was going to perhaps go in the direction of lawn ornaments, of that sort of you know inventory that would expand
in my
in that
garden
direction.
Center, I sold cement figurines, like little Buddhas and things like that. I sold stepping stones. So, you know, a stone that you could, you know, put in your garden. So I would imagine there'd be a few of those.
And not that it really matters to me, but currently those things are not in the inventory because those are outdoor garden things. And,
right.
And the current inventory is really indoor gardening.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any other questions from the board?
No.
No?
Not on that level questions.
Okay. Well, we'll have more opportunities, but... to ask questions, but before we get any further into the discussion about, let's assume for the sake of argument that we determine that this is an expansion of an existing use, which is, as I said, an essential threshold determination. The next question is whether your proposed expanded use is substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood. And that's where we get, I'm sure, into questions about added traffic especially with that kind of tricky intersection. I know years and years ago when my kids were at Jackson Street School, that was a nightmare on backing up on Jackson Street. And I also know when my kids were at the high school that Woodlawn is lined, maybe not that far back, with kids' cars from the high school. But those are kind of obvious concerns that we may want to talk about. But I think we can open it up and ask if any other members of the public would like to either ask questions or give comments relating to this application. If they're looking for more information or just have some opinions they want to share, and we'll go one at a time. And if people could just, again, name and address. I'm seeing in back there. Yes, please. Go ahead.
Am I the
only
one?
No,
okay.
You're
okay. forgive me, I'm not, public speaking is not my forte. Forgive my nervousness. I am Elizabeth Humphrey, and I own the property at 293 Prospect Street, which is the brick house directly across from Nodelman's, and on the corner of, directly on the corner of Jackson and Prospect. And so I have a front row seat to the traffic there at that corner. And prior to the Jackson Street sidewalk project, it was a nightmare. It was really scary, even on the sidewalk, for any kind of even light traffic, because the sidewalk was just directly right there. And the arborvitaes that I moved back eventually more into the property were really hard for line of sight originally. And when the sidewalk project was finished, I must say it was a relief to be much further back from the road with that grass strip in between the road and the sidewalk. And but even still, before the four-way stop sign went in, it was really scary. It was a scary corner, and I would be like on pins and needles, just you know, watching the kids trying to cross the street there. But since the four-way stop signs, I cannot say more emphatically that I thank the city for doing that. It has made such a huge difference that I was actually in shock. At first I thought, it's not gonna do much. It is an amazing night and day. My windows are right there, right at the front of the house, and that's my bedroom. And I can't help, they're old windows. I hear everything that's going on outside. I used to hear screaming, yelling, you know, tires screeching, people zooming around that corner because there was no stop sign there for Prospect. And since then, it has just calmed it down so much. I don't feel afraid about snowblowing my sidewalk now anymore. And I literally have noticed, like, people are more kind to each other. People are actually, there's very little road rage that I hear. And there's not even a fender bender every day. There used to be every single day. It was ridiculous. So I want to thank the city first for the four stop signs. Don't mean to be rambling. I really came up here just to give my positive opinion towards the expansion of the use of Nodelman's. I love the fact that it's, you know, going to be a garden center, so they're selling similar things, but like, so that their customers can kind of be almost symbiotic. And I must say that I'm looking forward to the beautification of the property as well. And if you don't mind, if I could just read real quick, so
sure.
I don't ramble.
Sure.
Let me see where I was like. I look forward to the improvement of the curb appeal and the property as a whole. It makes sense to me that the second business be a garden center, and the two would be a lovely complement of each other. I can't wait to see the beautification, especially with the Nodelman's property being directly next to Child's Park. I and two other neighbors that I have spoken to, Carol Saluzio of 11 Murphy Terrace and Beverly Hobart of 42 Murphy Terrace, feel the nature of this expansion of retail will not put an undue burden on the traffic flow, especially now with the four-way stop at the corner. All three of us feel the way the four-way stop is a success and makes our travel in and out of our properties much safer and easier. Lastly, my two neighbors agree with me that it is very important to our community to support locally owned small businesses. It is well known that locally owned businesses are good for our city's economy, as their revenues are kept within the community via taxes, jobs, for local residents, etc. I hope that the zoning board approves this garden center, and I look forward to giving them my business as a landowner.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Anyone else like to speak? Yeah, first in front first, and then we'll do in back.
Okay. I'm Scott Bradbury. I live at 95 Woodlawn Avenue. So on that plan, to the left is the YMCA parking lot, and then the basketball court, and then the Wise Field, and then me. So I'm the closest, I'm the nearest abutter on Woodlawn. If Dee carries out what she said she would do, that would really beautify things. And I also would appreciate that at that end of the street. So I hope that the board will simply look hard at the traffic situation. And I don't have a strong view of it. I agree with the person who just spoke that the four-way stop has really made a big difference in the quality of life around that intersection. It's done the job. And I think I'm persuaded that there wouldn't be so much traffic coming in here, but I'm not a professional on traffic flow. I just hope that you will, look hard at that problem and perhaps consider whether it might make sense to have to keep that Prospect right turn open. Would that help the actual flow of traffic rather than have it all go in and out of Woodlawn? There will be times, I think, when the traffic will be backed up from the intersection past the curb cut of Nuttallman's, in which case then you'd have gridlock. I'm not sure that the curb cut on Prospect resolves that, but those are just some of the issues that I would ask you to think about. You already know that, but other than that, I don't particularly like chain link fences. I hope you will find the most attractive one possible.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks very much.
Hi, I'm Julie Costello representing the YMCA. I don't live in town, but I am Northampton native, and my whole family is from Northampton, and sister lives on Massasoit Street where my grandparents used to live. So I'm back. I just have a few questions. I also agree with the, it would be really nice to have that look beautiful. And but being now at the YMCA and knowing what it's like on that street, and we now have 7,000 members plus all our participants, parking is a challenge. So my only concern really is if people are going to be jockeying for parking in our parking spots. And then I just had a few other questions about if we're planting, where are all the dead plants gonna go? I kill my plants, maybe you don't, but where will that kind of stuff that comes with planting, where will that be disposed of and how? Will there be more trucks coming in and out, and then where will the soil be stored, or the extra items that we're going to be selling, where will those be stored?
Maybe we'll ask if you could respond. Could you respond?
Sure, I can respond to that.
And then we'll go one at a time your
sure,
question.
Sorry.
No, I think it's helpful.
So in this particular spot here, so this is partially greenhouse, then there's this long shed, and at the end of the shed there's a, and this is open on three sides. So at the end of that is a closed up shed. It has a dirt floor, it's kind of a utility area. So certainly some kind of waste will go there. But I'm thinking that, and you're correct in that, you know, there has to be an area for turnover, use, things like that. And luckily I live very close, so I can take a lot of things home. But in this back corner over here could be an area, because this back corner, you know, isn't necessarily going to be used as retail space, and it's also not really visible. I mean, this back here, this drops down, and then there's the driveway for the back of the lot. So this back corner here might be a corner that I'd have a pile of soil, maybe compost for dead plants only. So kind of a working area.
So kind of on the slope that comes back as we're walking into the line, the side will be compost and stuff. On that hill?
It'll be within this fenced area. It won't be outside of the fence at all. There'll be nothing outside of the fence. Except for all these plantings will,
right,
of course.
Okay. I just get to hear everything all our members say, so I'm trying to to think of all the things that they will be asking me. So what else? So watering. I'm assuming the runoff and all of that will be drainage will have to be put in, or
so. Watering.
I'm just concerned with the slope in the parking lot being there on our side. I don't know how that would work.
So, owning a garden center for as long as I had, you don't want to overwater your plants. So you don't want
maybe
there to be
something.
Excess water. You know, you don't want excess water. And there really aren't pools of water standing around or anything. I actually have a new idea for a kind of a water basin to catch water and then reuse it. But these tables over here that will have plants on them, I mean, they'll be hand watered. So, you know, the person watering them is not going to overwater. So, yeah, there'll be a little bit of drippage underneath, but there's definitely not going to be a watering drainage issue or runoff.
Okay.
Currently, there isn't a runoff or drainage issue. Actually, the last time it rained, I went over there and kind of stomped around a little bit just to make sure. So.
And the way the fence is, again, is, so you're gonna put the fence there. In the winter with plowing, does that, I mean, we don't really push it onto there anyway, but if there's a lot of snow, what happens? I guess we would just have to take the snow away. Because now the fence is there.
You mean the snow that you normally
correct
plow onto their
property? Well, exactly.
That is what I'm saying.
Down behind they do.
Yeah.
But not over here by the hemlocks on the
isn't
lawn.
That kind of
can I?
Yeah, go ahead.
Can I respond to that?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, so I'm not arguing.
I'm just curious.
Yeah.
So are you talking about in the parking lot here?
Sure.
Okay.
So 15 feet.
Yeah, so when I went to measure and talk with the fence guy, the property that the YMCA owns, you guys own 5 feet into this green area. So the car stops, you own 5 feet in,
right?
Okay? And then the fence is gonna go 15 feet from in there.
So
unfortunately, it's gonna look a little odd because it's gonna look like this fence is in the middle of that property. Like I said, it's gonna look a little bit awkward, and the planting materials are gonna go, you know, this far from the fence. So you'll still have quite a bit of space if you plow the snow over that part. And you know, a lot of times if there's salt or, you know, snow has damage, but it won't, because I thought about this a lot when I was choosing the plants, you know, is that snow going to affect the plants? But the amount of setback and the amount of 5 feet that you have there, I think we're good to go. Yeah.
And bearing in mind that I'm not sure that that the Y has the right to put snow on without an easement.
No, they have 5 feet. They have 5 feet in there.
That they do have the right to occupy, with snow. Yeah.
So I'm totally comfortable with that.
Right. And I agree that we shouldn't be pushing snow onto Mr. Nolan's property either.
Right.
So I just didn't know if that's an issue now.
Yeah. No, the fence is going to be.
And then would the fence make it?
No, but it sounds like it will not.
To Chip about that.
Yeah. 15 feet is a lot. So it's actually 20 feet, really, from from your parking area. So it's like I said, it's going to make the fence look a little awkward being in the middle of that thing. But
it has to satisfy setback.
Or
that would be a zoning violation.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's fine.
That was it. And I agree with the chain link fence. I'm trying to figure out how to make the Y look better too. So that's it.
One of the things that we can talk about as a board before we decide tonight is other conditions to help to ensure that, in our view, it is not substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood, and that could certainly include some considerations relating to the fence. So I think we'll have that conversation. Yes?
Could I just comment on that a little bit? And I've had this discussion with Wayne quite a bit, that it's a residential area, so you want to try to blend in as much as possible, therefore all the plantings around there. But in my opinion, putting up a solid fence all around there is really not being inviting. It's blocking, it's excluding, basically, whereas this will be including. And certainly, the first year, those plants aren't going to be that big, but, even in 2 to 3 years, the plants are going to grow more. And also, I can plant inside that fence, too. So one of my ideas that I did at my garden center was to have a showcase of climbing plants. So basically, on this wall, you have climbing hydrangea, you have clematis, you have, so you could line them all up so people can walk in and say, oh, I like that climber. Oh, this is what that climber is.
But in winter, the obviously.
Well, some of them in winter won't, you're right, some of them in winter won't be evergreen.
Yeah. Is one possibility some sort of climbing plants on the outside of the fence that are evergreen, just out of curiosity?
Evergreen climbers are rare. I might be able to come up with one for you, but off the top of my head right now, I can't.
They'd be sensitive to salt from the road.
Right. There are some evergreens. There's Atlas fir, blue Atlas fir. Although it's not very leafy, it's a pine type.
Yeah.
But it doesn't have to be a climber. I mean, just having evergreens there.
Dana Chevrolet, which it's long gone, but then it was Dana Volkswagen. Wasn't there a green screen on the outside of that fence with evergreen plantings?
There were
not
trees.
Not climbing.
Trees.
Yeah. So I tried to, when thinking about this, I could have easily just said, okay, let's do arborvitaes all across here and all across there. If you want to cover that up,
we'll discuss it.
What you could do. But the reality is, this is a garden center.
Yeah.
So you want to showcase plants so that people can look at them and go, oh, and then time they drive by,
I understand your marketing concern and consideration.
Well,
but from the standpoint of a, at least on one side, a residential neighborhood with a new chain link fence. But we'll discuss it. I'm not forming an opinion yet. Any other comments or anyone else like to speak? And I want to make sure we read into the record the comment of the gentleman who had to leave. So why don't I do that? Okay, he had to leave early, so he addressed the board as follows. I own a house and live with my family at 82 Jackson Street, several hundred feet down from the location in question. I'm writing in support of this proposal to add a new business to the Nuttallman's location, one that sells plants and products to for outdoor use. I'm an avid gardener and a frequent visitor in season to the Hadley Garden Center and other such businesses, and would love to have a garden store so close by, one we could walk to. Indeed, the neighborhood is full of avid gardeners who spend their weekends tinkering outside and all have to drive several miles to shop for plants and supplies. I know there might be concerns among neighbors about this adding to the traffic in the already busy intersection. I walk through this intersection at least once a day and drive through several times. Given the scale of this business and how few people will drive there, I do not think this business will add notably to the existing traffic flow. The garden center's business will mainly be on weekend mornings and between school bus and commuting hours when the intersection is busiest. I think that means the business will be busiest when the intersection is least busy. Right, let me read that again. The garden center's business will mainly be on weekend mornings and between school bus and commuting hours when the intersection is busiest. I believe the neighborhood would be enriched by having such a business in it. Indeed, I would like to see additional businesses at the intersection, like a cafe and small food retail, perhaps in the future. Mm-hmm. Thanks for your consideration. Yours truly, Jonah Zuckerman. What's that? Oh yeah, there used to be.
Yes. Ice cream and then two restaurants. Breakfast restaurants.
And the little breakfast place, Deb's, I think.
Yes, and I miss them because I could just walk right out of my house and get breakfast.
So, is there anyone else from the public who would like to ask questions or comment on this application? Okay, seeing none. I think before we close the public hearing, we should have a discussion.
Well, I have one question for Mr. Nauman. Mr. Nauman, can I ask you? The shed that is, which way is north, between her fenced area and the YMCA, it looks like a underground greenhouse or something.
Well, this
that thing.
Back
I've wondered
here.
About that for 30 years. What is that?
Well, I call it the pit. I mean, I store stuff down there. It's really, years and years ago, we used to grow stuff down there.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't anymore. Then I had a bulb cellar down there. Mm. I used to grow bulbs for the spring, but now, well, it's cheaper to buy them through the market than it is to grow them. So it's kind of a catch-all. I mean, I have my lawnmower down there and stuff like that. So it's kind of just Christmas stuff.
It's a functional area, you know, down that hill and back.
Storage.
She's just not enclosing any of it with the fence.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
I wanted to ask Carolyn, do we have any comments from DPW or any other city offices or agencies? So from your standpoint, Carolyn, this concern about the Y, because I think it's one that didn't occur to me, the Y is down gradient, about water runoff, that from the standpoint of your office, that's not really a concern.
Yeah.
Because I think Sarah mentioned water is kind of expensive too. You don't want to be wasting it by having it run off the property. And similarly, the consensus seems to be that there shouldn't be water runoff or mud or compost or anything else going into the Y's parking lot to the left of the proposed center. I don't know what else we could do in terms of expert opinion on those two questions, but I think they're good questions.
It's very level up there.
It's level up there, and it sounds like it drains well for what that's worth from your experience.
From my limited experience of going there after heavy rains, it all seems to drain very well.
Okay. The next steps would be, let me just explain where we're going. Eventually, what we need to do before we take a vote is close the public hearing, but once we close the public hearing, people are welcome to stay and listen to our discussion and our vote, but once we close the public hearing, we can no longer receive any input from the applicant or the public, so I don't want to do that quite yet. And you go ahead, Maureen, with questions.
And it might be too to you as well, Carolyn. Should we inquire about if there'll be any changing to the outdoor lighting after hours? It being a business, but it's in a residential area.
Very
good question.
Very good question. Can you comment
can
on
I speak
that, please?
To yeah. that? As far as I know, there won't be any outdoor lighting.
Additional to what?
Additional to what he has okay. already. You know, he has lighting that's, I believe, on the sign, and there might be another one on the building itself, but there's no need for any lighting in the other.
Okay. So you don't intend to illuminate it in
yeah.
the evening?
No.
Right, and if we felt strongly, we could make that a condition of the finding as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That there be no additional outdoor lighting other than what's presently existing.
I would feel like that's wise.
I think that's
yeah.
a good idea too.
And the other is describing how you will winter it when you close for those few months. What will
right.
it look like?
So in the winter, the idea is that these tables will stay here. Basically everything, all the physical structures will stay there. But all the plants, hopefully there won't be any plants left, but anything else will be stored in this storage area, and there's some plastic pieces that I can put up against it to make it weatherproof. So it'll be cleaned up, tidied up, and that'll be it.
And some of the new plantings are deciduous, and some of them are evergreens.
Correct.
Many of them look like they're pretty hardy.
Oh, they'll all be hardy. So, like I said, in choosing those, I'm hoping that there will be minimum maintenance to those. You know, I've chosen plants that really don't require any kind of pruning, and so I'm hoping there's going to be no maintenance to that.
And the last one is for Carolyn. That planting, these roses that go, those are roses?
Yeah, I was hoping to put those knockout roses across there because they bloom most of the summer.
And you said a split rail fence?
Yeah, there's a split rail fence there now. We were hoping to change that to a new split rail and put the roses in front of it.
So, Carolyn, do we have any concerns about any height that might impact turning visibility at that intersection? There's a sidewalk, so it's set pretty far back.
Yeah, there's a standard in zoning that about those site distances and triangles and step back, so even if, so they couldn't.
Right. It would be an enforcement issue for the building
yeah.
inspector, right?
Right.
If,
so
if the building inspector saw something violating,
so
even
if
he
you
has the authority
the
to.
Even if you approved the plan and the roses got really tall, they would be required to bring them back down. Yeah.
I always wondered about the bushes where Federal Street turns left onto, is that Elm or Nonotuck? Those bushes there.
Mm.
It's,
oh,
it's,
yeah.
like a, it's so blind. But I think they must technically be legal because they've been there forever. So any other questions for the board? And no more questions or comments from the public.
I'm sorry. I
go,
did
sure.
forget because I was so nervous.
Absolutely.
If I may just
yes.
quickly address that. Specifically, I wanted to look out there just to get a really good idea on a really busy day over at Nettleman's. And so I sat in my window and watched off and on for about 3 hours from 2 until about 5, or actually 6, maybe a little longer, Valentine's Day. And I just wanted to see what it was like with so many cars in the parking lot. They were mobbed, and that's a specific day that they always get my all florists. And it was on the way going home, and when there was still a lot of traffic in that high volume traffic. I did not hear one honked horn. I was specifically looking for like major issues coming out of the Prospect curb cut, and most people chose to turn right. There was one person who decided they wanted to turn left, but the people were very courteous and like let them in. The people coming the other way were already stopped. I really was amazed. I was actually, wow, this four-way stop is really working. And then the majority of them did go out to Woodlawn, to be able to take a left further up towards the hospital, and the flow was not any more worse. At least, I'm not a professional. I don't do traffic reports, but just watching out my window, it was amazing. There was like no angry people for all the time that they were so busy, and that was an entirely full parking lot. People parking even where there isn't parking spaces too. So I just wanted to say that to you, and that's why I really didn't think that it would be such a burden on the traffic.
Thank you. Very
thank
helpful.
You.
Yes.
So I have a question. So you'll be deciding tonight?
Well, first of all, we lose this room in 10 minutes. So I think the question, and we could possibly move to another room, but question for the board, are we ready to close the public hearing, have a motion, discuss the motion, and then possibly vote? Okay.
I move we close the public hearing.
Okay, second?
Second.
All in favor, that's unanimous. And a motion, Sarah, do you want to do a motion, Sarah? And then we can consider conditions and
sure.
Second and then discussion,
well,
then vote.
My, I actually like the Prospect Street exit as an engineer with the no left turn signage. I think it takes a little pressure off of Woodlawn that can get kind of intense when it's overlapping the busy times of YMCA, which is a much one of the heaviest used facilities in town. As far as the application for the expansion of an existing use, I think this is a natural expansion. It's the kind of expansion that perhaps, you know, Nuttallmans might have done themselves with no permit. It could have just been happening naturally over the last few years. So I have no problem with the business, and I'll be happy to see it.
Okay. On the issue of the curb cut, we do have the opinion of people with more expertise than me that I assume because the proximity to the intersection, right, that makes it hazardous almost inherently because it's so close to the intersection.
It's true. There is a site distance as an engineer. There is a site distance that you don't have a lot of distance between the folks exiting Woodlawn who are at various times of day. They're mostly going straight to Jackson Street. It's true. If you're going to, especially if you're going to have, there's a bit of a hill there, it is better to have more distance. But I like the idea of having it as kind of a pressure release valve for when there's a big truck that can't turn around in there.
Well, no, but the gate can be open for trucks.
Mm-hmm.
That has been proposed.
So rather than removing it, having it be really for limited.
Yeah, fenced off and then opened for delivery trucks to pass through. But otherwise, my concern is that cars leaving on Prospect, even if they're just going right, have to feed in to the other activity of the four-way stop sign.
Well, not really. They're only feeding into the folks flowing in that one direction. But yes, that's true. You could have somebody who's been, you know, coming down from the hospital and they're impatient, and when they can finally go, they gun it.
Right, and just as this.
Right.
Yeah, or someone on Woodlawn who's been waiting in line,
and these people, the person waiting at the curb cut on Prospect may not even be able to see the blinker, the right-hand blinker of the one waiting on Woodlawn to turn right onto Prospect. That's the whole issue with this proximity problem.
I feel much safer with it being a service vehicle use only and chained off.
Yeah, I think that's where I come down also, and it's been offered by the applicant.
Mm-hmm.
The downside is added, as people have said, added burden to the Woodlawn. But to me, weighing the two, inconvenience versus safety, I sort of come down on going with what seems to be the safer proposal, and that is to close it off except delivery vehicles with a chain link, but not a chain link, but a chain, so that it, and then what about the fencing or trying to enhance the aesthetics of the fence in a residential neighborhood, especially in winter. For 5 months,
right,
the other than evergreen plantings, I could see it getting pretty bleak out there in an inside and outside of this chain link fence on a residential street.
I find that a very big misfit.
The chain link?
Yeah. Visually, in terms of quality of neighborhood. I don't know enough about fencing, or is it our job to come up with recommendations, but alternatives, but that just feels very, very out of keeping, particularly in that downtime, where there won't be plantings there, except for whatever does come develop in terms of evergreens.
I don't have a problem with the chain link, personally, especially when it has the black, it doesn't seem to be specified, but when it's got the black coating on it, it really kind of disappears.
So that's a possibility, that would be okay with the applicant, or is that what your
spec?
That's in the spec.
So it doesn't have the black specifically for that reason, so it's not.
They really kind of disappear with this level. I'm impressed with that level of plantings all around it.
And is the height of a given, does it need to be 6 feet?
I believe so, for security, and you wouldn't necessarily go higher. I think you need a special permit to go higher.
Right. No.
And lower wouldn't do any security.
Well, I think it sounds like we're in agreement that that this is an expansion of an existing use, and therefore it is appropriate for a finding. So on the issue of substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood, the discussions relate to the safety, and I think it sounds like there's a consensus to close off just with a chain and two posts as proposed by the applicant, so that we eliminate the safety concern of the curb cut on Prospect Street. The fence, I'm hearing a couple of things. I'm hearing that maybe with the black coating, it'll be a little less aesthetically jarring. And there will be some planting, some evergreen, some deciduous outside the fence. And
certainly, I could change that to have more evergreens if you wanted more evergreens.
And it's this space right here.
Oh yeah, that's right. You know what? We closed it, but that was my fault.
Strike that color.
It's the stretch on Woodlawn that to me is the going to be the most visibly out of keeping.
Okay, let's look at what she's got here.
So here.
Yeah, turn it here so I see the YMCA parking lot.
While they're looking, I think there's an agreement to satisfy setback requirements, right?
Kind of a vertical.
Yeah.
Kind of like maybe the size of an arborvitae. These hemlocks are pretty big.
Oh, but in this case they will. They're not required.
Yeah.
That's right.
Perennials is just perennial, whatever's in season.
Spots.
Hydrangeas, rhododendrons, those can get large. Or rhododendron, miscellaneous perennials, hydrangeas, and more dogwoods. I wouldn't want to have anything big over by the curb cut because that blocks that visibility.
So, I wonder how mature she can plant them. So we can start off a little higher.
We could ask for as mature as possible. We can.
Right. We have to put it on that list.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't. Unless we have some thoughts about alternatives, focusing on how to get the most out of those plantings, we'll probably set that off some. And it is not right up against the sidewalk, which helps.
Yeah, it is set back. That fence is also set back as per the plans.
Right,
10 feet. Yeah.
Carolyn reminds me that for a fence, the setback is not a requirement, but the plans satisfy the setback, and so the approval would be as per the plans.
Oh, okay.
So, ready for a motion?
Sure.
You need some paperwork here?
Please, then tell me the map and lot number.
Right.
Thanks very much. I move that we approve the commercial finding by Justin Nuttleman requested by Justin Nuttleman to expand retail use by adding second business to 292 Prospect Street, 135 Woodlawn Avenue, Northampton map ID 24C 20 with the conditions. There will be no additional site lighting, and that the Prospect Street exit will be closed except for service vehicle.
With a chain.
Closed with a chain. And, that would be it. I guess it'd be good to have a sign on that. It says service exit or something, or. The chain will stop the car. Okay.
What about if the composting within the fence or condition?
I have no concerns about that.
You're not worried about that, okay.
If it's within the fence.
Well, no, do we make it another condition that all composting has to be done within the fenced area?
Chet might be doing some composting back here around his shed and work area back here.
Since it was a specific question from the Y, and the answer was that it would be all contained within the fence, I would feel more comfortable.
It has been offered, so why not?
You can just specify that it's per this use so that Netherlands can continue to do what they've done historically.
Right, that's a good point.
Yeah.
But for the nursery,
right,
as offered, composting would all be contained within the fenced area. Okay, for a condition.
Mm-hmm.
Second to the motion.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? Are we leaving anything out here? So the fences will satisfy setbacks. Any other conditions relating to the plantings? Oh, a condition that the initial plantings be as mature as possible without, what's the language?
I think you need to be specific.
Oh, you can't say that. That's not specific enough.
Because you can buy almost any size stock. I mean, if you want something like
the height or size, yeah.
Well, and which plantings are you talking about? The evergreen, the rhododendron, or?
I really don't want to get into the planting plan, personally. I mean, she's a professional who's going to try to make it really pretty.
I feel like she's doing a really good job. And we are not equipped to know how to qualify that.
So, what we could do is continue it to get a revised planting plan.
You've already closed the hearing.
Oh, that's right.
So we're okay.
Okay, we're good. Okay, so I guess just a vote on the motion with those conditions. All in favor? It's unanimous. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
And we'll just vote to adjourn, right? No minutes.
I will get
second to adjourn. All in favor?
Scott, you couldn't.